All right, so my name is Nancy Alvarez. I'm an anchor and reporter here at West 2 News, and I have been in the news business for 23 years. My first job in news, I was 23 years old, and I was assigned Brevard County. And under the Brevard Bureau job was the Kennedy Space Center. And the only other time I had ever been there was a field trip when I was in like fifth grade. And now I'm 23, a new reporter, and assigned the space program. And to say it was overwhelming is an understatement. I was terrified. I used to go to sleep watching the Space Channel and wake up with it still on, because it was just this constant flow of information, and I was trying to learn. You know, I was just trying to learn. How do they cover this? What do they cover? What are the stories I can pitch from KSC, you know? And it also put me right in the middle of some incredible journalists. Right, to be 23 years old and assigned the space program, what? I suddenly found myself surrounded by these veterans, right, of journalism and of the space program, and people who just knew so much, and I was like a sponge. I just asked all the questions, I followed people around. I used to see Dan Bilow and just kind of fangirl, you know, and say, oh, there he is. And he helped me a lot too, you know, because there's a lot of things that I didn't understand. And, you know, just being thrust into news for the first time in my life at such a young age, that meant deadlines I've never experienced before. It meant assignments that I'd never, you know, faced before. And then to top it all off, I'm in the middle of the Kennedy Space Center with all these veteran journalists. So Dan Bilow certainly became, you know, a mentor and a role model for me very quickly.
Did there come a point in time where sort of the general public and maybe even media, local media especially, covering so many shuttle launches and landings, did it become sort of commonplace?
So, that's a good question, because I think it did, you know? I think I lived in Brevard County and I worked there and I became part of that community for many years. And yeah, you know, it was just sort of like, yeah, they're selling some t-shirts down here on the side of the road in Titusville for this mission. And it did become so commonplace and so normal, right? I mean, for me, I was young. So for me, it was, every time was extraordinary. And the night launches, oh my gosh, to see a night launch. I remember the lake in front of the press site at night. And when that shuttle went up and everything lit up and like night turned into day, you could see the fish jumping. You could see the fish jumping because the water, you know, was vibrating from the power of the shuttle. And I just was blown away. I just couldn't believe, you know, that I was privileged enough to witness something like that. So for me, being so young and being out there and seeing all this for the first time, it was extraordinary. But I was passing people, you know, in the cafeteria at the Kennedy Space Center, and it was just another day at work, you know?
Think that the loss of Challenger, right? You think sort of, you know, we look back at it and it reframed the missions for a lot of people. But did it feel like it became nothing bad can happen again?
I think there was a lot of confidence, you know, in that time because things were going so well. And we had all these incredible people going up in these missions. I mean, if you look at even just Columbia, Kalpana Chawla was the first female Indian astronaut, and then Ilan Ramon was just the pride of his country, the first Israeli astronaut. And so really, the stories, at least that I was doing, were more focused on who they are and, you know, much less the technology, right, and all the things that had to happen for these missions to be successful. The stories, you know, shifted over time. The story shifted over time, right? I think after Columbia, I'm sure I was a kid, but I'm sure there was a focus, tremendous focus on safety and, you know, what it's going to take for these missions to be successful. But you start to get comfortable and you start to get back to like the excitement, right, of these missions and of these launches and, you know, who they are and who are these astronauts and what's their story. And those are the kinds of things that I was focused on. I don't remember. I covered, you know, the launch of Columbia, and I don't remember talking about safety. I don't remember really, you know, talking about anything technological. I was talking about the astronauts and the excitement of Ilan Ramon for Israel and Kalpana Chawla for India and the stories of these people and their families. That was the focus. And I think that that probably shifted over time, right, since Challenger. I think it was a big deal because of who was on board. You know, I think that these people all meant something extraordinary to their foundations, to where they came from. And I attach myself so closely to Ilan Ramon. He was the first Israeli astronaut. We saw him out there with his family and these little kids, you know, following him around. He was handsome. He looked like a superhero, you know, and he had this incredible following. And this was before social media. You know, I wasn't on Ilan Ramon's Facebook page. This was just what I was observing, you know, with my own eyes, just seeing the excitement that was surrounding him and the pride of his country. Kalpana Chawla as well, the first, you know, Indian female astronaut. And she was just such a source of pride. I remember for her father, who I saw out there. And these people just meant so much to so many. And I think that's what made the mission special. I remember I was assigned to getting, you know, reaction from people, the crowd, you know, the anything and everything, just any reaction I could get from people. And I remember it was uneventful, you know, it was just another launch. And it was, you know, it was exciting. And I remember somebody said at some point, Ilan Ramon's family is heading back to the hotel. See if you can catch them. So I did. I got in a news car and I headed to the hotel where they were staying. I want to say Cocoa Beach, maybe Satellite Beach, something beach out in Brevard. I don't remember exactly where we were, but I remember pulling up in my news car, my little Ford Contour that I had, and I pulled up and sure enough, they were getting out of a car. And I approached them, and I remember, I think I asked his wife how she was feeling, and she expressed, you know, excitement and that it was a beautiful launch and it was incredible. And I think one of his boys may have given me a soundbite and talked to me. And then what I will remember for the rest of my life, his daughter, who was 5 years old at the time, had a little baggie and she had a mission pin in this bag. And she took out the pin and she handed it to me. And I had it in my hand and I remember what the pin looked like. And I said, oh my gosh, thank you so much. This is so nice of you. And her brother was standing next to her and he said, you know, that's your last pin. And I looked at him and I looked at her and she just kind of shrugged. And I said, don't give me your last pin. You need to keep this pin. And she goes, okay. So I gave her back the pin. And I'm so glad I did. You know, I look back on that and it's such a minor, silly thing. But yeah, I would have loved to have had a mission pin, but giving it back to her and her having her last, you know, that last pin, that last little piece of this incredible thing that her dad was a part of, you know, was really special. And that exchange with her was so ordinary, but then it became extraordinary after everything happened. Yeah, so we left our station in Orlando like in the middle of the night. My photographer, my good friend Mason, he had never seen a landing before. And I can't stress enough how young I was because I was so excited, you know, and he was older than me and probably tired because he had to get up in the middle of the night. But oh my gosh, was I over the moon because we were going to see this shuttle come back. And I remember driving out to the coast and telling him, it's the coolest thing. I mean, it looks like an airplane. You wouldn't believe this thing's coming back from space. It just glides like nothing. And I just kept setting him up and, you know, really pumping him up because I was so excited that he was going to see this for the first time. And, you know, it was just all so ordinary. We got there. It was the same group of people. And we all loaded up on the media, you know, bus that takes us out to the landing strip. And I could see the families in the distance on the bleachers. And the bleachers were packed with people. And I can't stress enough just how ordinary it all was. It was all routine. The forecast was fine. Everything was fine. And I stood in front of the camera and the time came and went. And we, all of us, just started doing this. All of us, I remember everybody. Experienced or not, you know, journalists, Kennedy Space Center employees, the people on the bleachers, the guy who drove us on the bus out there, everybody just started like as if one of us was just going to magically find it all of a sudden, you know? And then there was just so much confusion. And I don't know if it was, honestly, I don't know if it was my lack of experience or my age or all of those things combined, but I was in a 100% state of shock, and I was completely confused and sure that I was missing something. Like, I'm new at this, I'm really young, clearly something's going on and everybody else knows and I'm just the idiot, you know what I mean? Like, I'm missing something here. And I kept, again, that's all we kept doing is looking at each other and looking up. It's all we did. We looked at each other and we looked up. We looked at each other, we looked up. And then in one of those rounds of looking at the people around me and looking up, I looked at the bleachers. And it was like a sudden wave. Like, they all got up almost at the same time. And it was this immediate wave of clearing out those bleachers and those family members and getting them, you know, away from that runway. And then the journalists that were there, you know, we were the second wave. And they were immediately getting us on the bus to go back to the press site and telling us that we would get more information when we got there. And again, you know, I don't know if it was a combination of my youth and my inexperience at this job, because I had just started this. I had just started covering this program. I just was convinced that, like, I was missing something. Like, the shuttle landed somewhere, and I just hadn't found out about it yet, because I don't have the connections that Dan Billow has. So Dan Billow, I'm sure, knows exactly what happened, but I don't, because I'm new here, you know? And it wasn't long after I got to the press site where I realized, no, we were all confused. We were all in a state of shock. And then it really became a Texas story. Right? And then we started, you know, we sent a reporter to Texas, and it became, and you know what, it was this overwhelming feeling of helplessness, because I was at the Kennedy Space Center, where it was supposed to have a happy ending, where I was looking forward to doing a story about this amazing, you know, reunion that Ilan Ramon had with that little girl that I had just talked to, you know, a few days before. And it just took this dark, horrific turn. And there was nothing I could do. There was really nothing to show. There was nothing to see. There was nothing. And that nothingness was like overwhelming. So it was hard to report on. There was no, as you can see behind me, there was no, you know, here at the Kennedy Space Center, this is happening. We were all helpless. There was nothing to do there.
Do you remember being on TV and having to talk? Because we do that a lot.
Yeah.
Like, just get on TV
and talk. Yeah, talk. Yeah. So yeah, and what I did on TV really was reflect, what I did on TV that day just was simply try to convey that feeling of shock and helplessness at the Kennedy Space Center. The Kennedy Space Center was supposed to be the place where the story was. We were supposed to be the place that was bustling with activity and video opportunities and sound bites. You know, we were the ones that were supposed to be busy that day. People in Texas weren't supposed to be busy that day. You know, this wasn't their story, it was our story. And when we were left with nothing, no landing, no shuttle, nothing to talk about except the shock of it all. That's all I could convey on TV that day. The nothingness of it, the nothingness that was happening at the Kennedy Space Center. I do have a very vivid memory of, it's kind of how I felt after Pulse, you know. When you live in Brevard County and you work in Brevard County and you cover the space program, it becomes very personal. And it's the same group of people, it's the same reporters, it's the same people at the press site putting us on the bus and taking us out there. And all of a sudden, there was reporters from all over the world and cameramen from all over the world and spokespeople from all over the world and all this. And it just felt like they were invading on our little home. Does that make sense? I remember being at the memorial doing live shots, and there were reporters with me from around the world. And it felt like they were invading us, you know? I don't know if I'm explaining it right, but it all just felt, as big as the shuttle program was, and you know, when you look at what it meant to, you know, the world and all these different countries that were invested in the space program, in Brevard County, it was very personal, it feels small. It feels small town. And it sounds crazy to say that because you're talking about the space program. It's so big. But in Brevard County, man, it's personal. And it's the same people, you know, reporting on it, working on it. And we were a community. And when Columbia happened, it was extraordinary to see how many people just descended on Brevard from all over the world and these reporters I was surrounded with. And I remember thinking, just go home. It was hard. It was a lot, you know?
Talk to me more about that time after. You know, we know that Columbia is lost, mm-hmm. and it becomes this time of mourning, mm-hmm. but at the same time, it becomes a time of investigation. Mm-hmm. What was it like to be in Brevard County, covering Brevard County, but covering NASA and the space program in that period?
It was probably one of the biggest learning lessons of my life and my career. And it shifted so quickly from what I thought this coverage would be, because remember, this was the coverage of heroes, of Israel's first astronaut, of Kalpana Chawla and what she meant, you know, to her country and to women. You know, and it was going to be all these extraordinary stories. And then it became the story of what happened to those tiles. And what did we miss? And how did we miss it? And how did that happen? You know, and it just shifted so quickly. And it was intense. It was very intense. It was difficult to wrap your head around that this could have been prevented. You know, and I remember that video where you see it. I don't think anyone will ever forget that video and that second where you see it. You see it coming off. And that's the moment that everything changed, that all these lives changed. We would never be the same after that. And it only took a second. And you see that video of that tile just flying off. And you think, how did we miss that? You know, how did they? It was so hard. And it was hard to see the people that work out there. Again, I mean, in Brevard County, it's personal. You know, it's not a job, it's a lifestyle. When you invest your career and your life into the work at the Kennedy Space Center, this isn't a job. It's a passion, you know, it's a lifestyle, and it was so personal and so devastating for the people that work there. It was like they lost a family member. I did cover the space program for years after Columbia. It was obviously very different, you know, everything changed. And there was obviously that long, you know, pause in launches, and then there was the return to flight and the, you know, excitement. But, you know, trauma is real. And I believe that everyone that was out there that day on that runway doing this, I believe that there's some trauma there that is gonna live with all of us forever. I do believe that. Because it is something that you had to be there to truly understand, just the horror of watching those families leave those bleachers, you know, knowing that they had just lost their dad, their daughter, their spouse. That was the story. And later the story became, you know, the tiles and the heat shield and what went wrong and what could have happened and could have, would have, should have. But for me, the story will always be those people clearing out of those bleachers. And that confusion and that tension and the questions and then knowing that that little girl lost her dad. That was it for me, you know? And I don't think anyone that was there that day will ever forget.
Has there ever been anything in your career that has come even close to this, touching you? Mm. Talk about that feeling of the the people leaving the bleachers. Has there been anything even remotely close?
Yeah, the only other time I ever felt that sense of like hopelessness and overwhelming grief was Pulse. You know, the loss of that magnitude was probably the only other time in my career where I just felt gutted, just completely gutted. And I always felt like there was nothing I could say on TV that would do justice to the loss.
After being there, the next shuttle to come back, mm-hmm. how did you feel when you saw that shuttle pop through the clouds with the landing gear down?
Yeah. It was extraordinary to see Brevard County back, you know what I mean? Because for me, the story always went back to the community. And I was so proud to cover that space program, but really it was more about the people who have invested their whole lives and careers into the space program. So seeing a shuttle back was seeing them back, you know? It was seeing Brevard County back for what it's known for what it's good at. And that's what I think about even now when I watch these rockets go up. Isn't it like every other day a rocket goes up? I think about the people in Brevard County. That's what we're about. You know what I mean? That's the story for me. It's these people that go to work every day and do these extraordinary things. And I tell my kids, you live in a place where we are sending things and people into space. You can't do that anywhere else. How amazing is that? And that is the legacy of those astronauts that we lost, because we're doing it bigger and better now. And I hope that, I know that people that work out at the Kennedy Space Center honor them every day by just by doing their jobs, you know, particularly the people that were there back then. They're still working there now, and every day they go to work is a day that they honor those astronauts that we lost, because we're still at it. We're still doing it, and Brevard County is still, you know, number one in the space game, and I'm so proud of that. I do remember doing stories, you know, on the emotional impact of something like that on a community. I mean, remember, the children of people who work at the Kennedy Space Center knew about that launch, were watching that launch, and they know that those astronauts died. Everyone is invested, right? Everyone has a tie. It's such a big part of that community. So I did do stories after on, you know, just, I remember going to the t-shirt company that, you know, always made the t-shirts for all the launches. There would be no launches, right? We didn't know when they would ever be making t-shirts again. And it seems like such a simple thing. And, you know, we did the economic impact stories, right? We did that for a long time. Like, what's the economic impact of no launches? But really, my gosh, what was the emotional impact, you know, for a community that took such pride in this program to see what happened and to know that, you know, perhaps it's something that could have been prevented, caught. That's tough. That's a huge toll on a community. And I think everyone felt it. I think it trickled down, like I said, to the children of employees at the Kennedy Space Center who watched their parents live through something like that. I mean, it really, so I think it did change Brevard County for a while. I think it took a long time to recover, you know, from that. But I honestly can tell you, I think that some people that were working there that day, some people that were, you know, around me and with me along that runway, all of us doing this, I think that's a trauma that will live with all of us for the rest of our lives. I don't think we'll ever forget what that felt like. I feel old talking about it, but no, it's just incredible to see. I mean, the advances that we've made and how much things have changed and how, I always wonder, you know, what they would think if they were here and saw this and saw how quickly we are sending these things up and back and down and again, and it's just incredible. I'm going to sound old, but to me, there was nothing like the shuttle. There was nothing like the shuttle. I mean, to see something that enormous just lift up, and it seemed like effortless, you know? And it just did leave a very, very lasting impression on me, all those launches, because I was so young, you know? And I mean, anybody, any age, right? But for it to be one of the first things I ever covered, my gosh, I've always said in my career, if I could launch a shuttle, I could do anything. I can talk about anything. What you got? You know? So, yeah, that was the foundation of my career, was the space program. And it challenged me in extraordinary ways. And I think I'm a better reporter and a better journalist because I started there. Yeah.
Once you found out, like, really what happened, you know, yeah. What was it like, you know, for you to see those streaks across the sky on video?
Oh, my God. Okay, I'm going to tell you what I did, and I wasn't going to tell you this, but I'm going to tell you, it doesn't matter. So, we got a phone call once we got back to the press site, and they told us that the shuttle broke apart over Texas, and I started crying. And I called my dad, because I was a kid, and my dad said, you have a job to do, so you need to get off the phone with me now. And so I wiped my tears and I did my job for the rest of the day. But that's what happened. That's when I found out I started crying. Because it, for me, it wasn't the shuttle, and it wasn't like, my mind didn't go to, you know, what happened and technically what went wrong and what was the temperature when they were re-entering and did the heat shield, you know, work? Was it compromised? My mind didn't go there. My mind went to Ilan Ramon's little girl, and she just lost her dad. Like, that was it for me. Like, I didn't think about anything else. I just literally thought about the spouses and the parents and the children who had just lost these extraordinary people. And so I started crying, and I called my dad, and I said, I can't believe this, they're all gone. I said, they're all gone, they're gone. And my dad listened, and he said, you have a job to do, so you need to get off the phone with me now. So I got off the phone, and I went on with my job. And I became a better journalist that day. I learned, you know, that's the time in my career when I was learning that you take all that hurt and that anguish and that grief, and you just put it over here for a little while because you have a job to do. And that was probably the first time in my career where I had to do that. And so I reported on, what I was seeing around me, on the shock and the grief of the faces of the people at the Kennedy Space Center that worked there. There were seasoned employees who I saw crying, you know, leaning on each other, hugging. It was a personal loss for them. It was as if they had lost a family member.